Thank you. How are you?
Good to see you. Sugamano Karun.
Sugam.
Engane karyam?
Karyangal quiet aayittund quarantined at home.
എനിക്ക് ഫസ്റ്റ് ആയിട്ട് ഒരു സംശയമുണ്ട്. നിങ്ങളത് മലയാളം ഒരുപാട് ബെറ്റർ ആയിട്ട് ഉണ്ടാ അല്ല നിങ്ങളത് കന്നഡ വളരെ ഫ്ലുവൻ്റാ?
എരടു കുറച്ച് കുറച്ച് അറിയാം.
Nicely put. But you've actually spent all your time in Bangalore, right? You're one of those Bangalore days, Mallu boys who has grown up in Bangalore. And what's the best part of being a Malayali in Bangalore?
Yeah, I have grown up in Bangalore. I was born in Jodhpur, Rajasthan, and then moved to Bangalore very soon after. So the best part about being Mallu in Bangalore, I think Bangalore is a city where you find a lot of cultures and a mix of cultures. So it's amazing to meet new people. It's not you find a variety of people and you find variety of things to do in Bangalore. So that's the best part of being a Mallu in Bangalore. And you also find a lot of Kerala cuisine.
Absolutely, I think that's the best part. I guess some of my best Onam memories are actually in Bangalore, and especially in Indiranagar, which almost seems like a mini Cochin, so to say.
Yeah, it is. Indiranagar is a spot where you can find, like I said, Indiranagar is one of those spots in Bangalore where you find a lot of different cuisines and a lot of different restaurants. So Mallu restaurants are easy to find anywhere.
Obviously. And when you were actually born, you were this prematurely born baby, right? So you were probably asked not to put too much stress on your body early on. Then how did all this sporting pursuit happen?
You're right, the thing is, I think my parents were asked to put me into some kind of sport so that the okay. lungs develop and grow into being normal. So at first my parents went through a lot of struggle trying to do things with me, but they were there. I used to lose breath at certain points of time, and they used to hit my back to bring me back into, I can't explain what they used to do, but they used to they used to give me a wrap on the back. And the doctor said, I need to be doing some physical activity so that the lungs grow faster and become normal.
That actually does sound a little scary. What was it for you growing up? Did you look at it as a necessary thing for you to, just keep doing so that your health is in decent order? Or did you really enjoy what you were doing?
Not really. By the time I realized what was happening, I don't think I remember what had already happened. It was at a very young age. And by the time I was old enough to understand things that were happening, I didn't know about all this, and my parents never told me about it also, that I have such a problem. So it was just, I was just being a normal kid on the road playing cricket, and that's how it started.
Your mom, I believe, is a school teacher, of course, and your dad also had some role to play, right, as an engineer in the installation of the sprinkler systems in KSEA. What was your upbringing like? Were they strict? Who was the stricter of the two? Who was the more malleable of the two, who probably just let you get away with a few shaitani things?
My mom actually didn't want me to play on the road because she thought it was dangerous, and both my parents saw that I was so keen on playing the game that they decided to put me in a academy. And if I had to get away with things, it was with my dad. I think my mom used to always catch me for all the wrong things I did, and she was very strict when I was young. And she was very although she wanted me to go to a camp and start playing cricket, she also wanted me to complete my studies and do well in studies as well. So that was her part, like the studies was her part, and taking me to the ground and making sure that I practice and all was my dad's part. So both of them used to do their parts, and they were my mom, like I said, my mom was a stricter one, and my dad used to make sure I got up in the morning to go for practice. There are days when you're young that you don't want to wake up early in the morning, but my dad used to make sure that I woke up and slept early on time, and then wake up for practice.
I remember right after the time that you secured your Delhi Daredevils contract, which was this fat IPL contract, I asked you if there was going to be any party at home. And then your response with a straight face was, conservative family, yeah. Is that the same case even today?
Very much, you know, we've remained the same, very conservative middle class family. And whatever happens and whatever, you know, whatever things that, you know, we are fortunate enough to get and we are lucky enough to, you know, get so far, you know, just, you know, be grateful to the game and grateful to everyone that has supported you throughout and, you know, not let that get into your head and just keep working hard as you have always done.
Absolutely. And KL Rahul has been a friend of yours for a really long time. Do you remember the first time you met him, where and how?
I think it was a very long time ago. I think we must have been 11 years old, I think. We were probably playing against each other in one of these zonal games, Bangalore versus Mangalore. And, you know, that's the first time I actually heard of him. And then soon after, I think a year later, we were part of the state team. And, you know, that's when we started to get to know each other. And that's, so we've been friends for a long time. We've been friends for like 16 years, I think, if you do the math. Well,
yeah. Did you guys hit it off right from the start, right from the get-go? Did you find something, you know, mutually interesting that you just thought you are like naturally meant to be friends?
See, when you're so young and you meet people and you're, when you're 12 years old, you know, it's, you become friends naturally. You don't have any egos or anything at that point of time. You just want to enjoy the game. You're traveling together to a certain place. You're playing the game you love the most. And you're playing with 15 other people and you're just enjoying and, you know, you're enjoying everyone's company. And so that time we all started together. Mayank was in the same team. Rahul was in the same team. So I think we've known each other for so long that, you know, the bond keeps just growing with every year that we pass by.
There is this fantastic generation of Karnataka batsmen that includes you, of course, KL, Manish, Mayank as well. All of you are more or less of the same age. And it also at least appears from the outside that you have got a fantastic off-field bonding that's going on as well. Is that one of the reasons why you think Karnataka has been doing as well as it has been? I sense a cheeky smile there.
Yeah, I think because, you know, for the past, I think the reason we've done, Karnataka has done really well is, first of all, you know, the association, you know, provides so many facilities to youngsters to, you know, follow their dreams and follow what they want to become. And there's so much around you that you cannot, you know, with so much around you, so that you just have to work hard and then put in your work, and then everything is a process and it's step by step. And I think credit should go to the Karnataka State Cricket Association, first of all, for giving us the opportunities and the facilities and, you know, the stage for people to come up. And we've been, I think, our generation has been lucky to be born in a time where, you know, the facilities are great and we've had a lot of opportunities. And like you said, we've grown up together. So, and the best part was we all got into the Ranji team at almost the same point of time. And, you know, all of us were doing really well in the age group level. And if I look back, you know, we were really hungry to, you know, all of us were really hungry to, you know, go to the next level and do well in the next level. It wasn't that we just wanted to play Ranji Trophy. And it was like a group coming in to play, you know, to play the highest level, to play for India and actually having the talent to play for India. So all, you know, bonded really well at that stage. And it still is, you know, we have a great bunch of guys and who all want to play the highest level. And I think all are talented enough to play the highest level. So so it's just about us playing to our potential on the day. And then if we all have seen that we can beat any team in the country. So we've been dominating for the last 10 years. It's, and I think, you know, with the group of guys we have, we're so young still, we can really do well in the future as well.
Absolutely, no two ways about that. Also, what are your earliest memories of watching a cricket match? I mean, the first cricket match that comes to your memory.
I think the earliest what I can remember of is the matches in Sharjah.
Right, the Desert Storm.
The Desert Storm matches, and when Sachin was, you know, hitting everything out of the park against Australia. I think even Zimbabwe was involved in that series. So I think that was the earliest memory, and that's when, you know, I still remember I used to only watch Sachin play. I didn't want to watch anyone else. If Sachin got out, the TV would be off and, you know, I would go to sleep. And I used to do everything that he used to do. So that's how it started. The cricket, for me, cricket started by watching him and trying to do things the way he did. So he was my inspiration at first when I actually started understanding the game and, you know, watching the game. I used to only try and do what he did on the ground, and whatever techniques he had or the way it looked on TV, you know, I used to try and copy it, be it the stance, be it the backlift, and be it anything. So I think that's where my, you know, cricket started.
Another person that's been pivotal in your development is, of course, Rahul Dravid. I remember seeing that photograph of yours as this chubby little kid on Instagram, posing next to Rahul Dravid when you were probably 9 or 10. And then, you know, just cutting to when you're in your 20s and you're playing under Rahul Dravid's mentorship, under his coaching and counsel. It looks very surreal from outside. How has the whole journey for you been, and in terms of, you know, having Rahul Dravid to have your back every single time?
I think the first memory of me meeting him was when I think I was 14 or 13. I was part of the under 15 NCA, and also at that time I done really well in the you know, the matches that happened in Bangalore, like the under 19 selection games. When I was 14 itself, I was doing really well in the under 19 selection games, and also there's this what's it called, the Timmappaya Trophy that Karnataka State Association organizes. So I did well in a couple of games and of those matches as well. And then I was asked to come for practice of the Ranji Trophy team. So I went. I was asked to go there to attend the practice, and I was given batting also in that net session. And Rahul Dravid happened to be there watching that net session, and he saw me bat. And then after the net session, he called me over, and he spoke to me for some time. He said he was he encouraged me. He said what he saw, and then he also gave me a bat on that day. I still remember he gave me a BDM bat. Being a 14-year-old to receive a bat from Rahul Dravid, you know, was amazing. And that's my first memory of meeting him. And then, you know, then the next thing I know is, you know, I'm playing in an IPL team where he's the coach. And again, he had the faith in me to select me in that team and then give me a chance also to play in the IPL. So that's when I really actually got to know him. Like, I spent 2 months with him, and you know, asked him a lot of things, like how he went about his cricket and how the things he did. And then also, just by looking at a person, you can learn so much with how they work and how their work ethics are. And I learned so much. And from then on, you know, I've been part of his IPL team for 4 years after that. And then he was a coach of India A, and I was part of the India A squad also. So it's been, you know, a very good relationship that I've had with him. And he's always supported me, and he's always, you know, backed me in any situation that I've been under. He's always told me, just go and express yourself and be yourself out there.
You've spoken about learning things from just watching him. Any particular thing that stands out for you that you have picked up, you know, just by observing him go about things?
Like I said, the work ethic that he has, you know, even as a coach, the focus and the focus on practice and on quality practice, not the quantity part of it. Like, he always focuses on quality practice. He always believes in, you know, making sure that you do things right in practice first, and then it, you know, follows in the match. So that's one thing that I have always learned from him is, you know, the work ethics that he's had.
And also, have you had, have you basically sought him out during the time that you've been out of the India side and in the last year and a half for a bit? Have you tried and sought him out, you know, just for advice, just for counsel? What have your conversations been like?
See, he's always available at the NCAA, and, you know, we being in Bangalore, we are lucky to, you know, have such a facility in Bangalore. And yeah. He's there daily. You can walk up to him anytime and speak to him about any problems you have. And there's been so many occasions where, you know, I practice in the same ground, in the KSAB ground, that he walks up and he if he notices some things, he walks up and tells me what he noticed. And, you know, we have a chat right there then and correct the things that I have to. And, you know, that's just been the case over the last few years. There's been times, yes, I've walked up to him and told him whatever I felt, and he just said, you know, you need to let the bat do the talking, and nothing else matters. That's it. You know, it's just been very simple, very short, to the point, and always focusing on yourself and not others.
Both as far as your general life outside of cricket is concerned, as well as your cricketing career is concerned, who's your go-to person for advice or suggestion when you feel that you're probably a little low, not in the best frame of mind?
Generally, you know, when I need to talk to someone, I go to my coach, PV Shashikant sir. In the last few years, I've gone up to him a few times, and we've, you know, actually worked. Whenever we have had pre-season, we have worked together. We have worked very hard at our batting. And like I said, also, whenever I'm practicing at the KSA, right, I always go up to Rahul Dravid and ask him. So even if you're not doing well in Ranji Trophy, you still have to go back to the KSA B ground and practice. So that's...
Yeah,
you're not doing well in some games, he's there every day. So I always go up to him, and or he always, you know, if he sees something wrong, he always tells me whatever is wrong with me.
I see K. Gautam pop up. So he's asking who your go-to bowler is. But before that, I must tell you that a couple of days when Gautam was on this live, he did actually say that you are one of the most, you're one of the cleverest sledgers in the Karnataka side. Is that true?
I don't think so. I don't know. I don't want to say I'm the cleverest or anything. It's just that, you know, you need to do what you need to do to win games of cricket. And any...
attention to that question. I mean, all we see of Karun is this very studious looking... goody-goody, like, you know, very prim and proper boy. Like, but beneath all that exterior, is there a streak of mischief that's hidden somewhere?
I think everyone has that side to them. It's just about, you know, how many people show it, how far they go to show it. But so I've been really, you know, maybe smart enough to show it only at the right times, and, you know,
right,
show it very subtly, to do things very subtly, so that, you know, you don't get into unnecessary trouble, and make sure you do things right, and also do things so that, you know, it works for the team and works well for the team.
I remember that your father and your mother were present at the JPOC when you made that historic 100. And I remember, obviously, they were filled with pride and they were completely mobbed by the press. Is that a memory that they keep talking about a lot at home?
Not really. I think, yes, they got mobbed, and for that moment, you know, they didn't know what to do and they didn't know where they're at. And my mom actually wanted to just run away back home. She didn't want to stay there any longer. So that was the mob that she was under. And but not really. They don't talk about it much. We don't, you know, talk about things like that at all, because, you know, I don't think there's, you know, much to talk about it, unless like things like these interviews happen. And when we talk about this now, my mom might just call me up and say, you know, like she's thought about that moment and whatever and whatever happened and all that. Yeah.
Is that triple century question, which is almost inevitable, right? For the last 4 years, I think there hasn't been a single interview that you've been allowed to get away from the triple century question. Does that question become a little tiresome after a point?
See, I've realized that it's not gonna leave me for life. It's gonna stay with me for life. So and it's something that I'm proud of.
Right.
It's not everyone that scores a triple century, and really yeah. Proud to be able to say that I've done it. And you know, yeah, so like you said, it doesn't I've accepted that you know, it's going to come back, and it's going to keep coming back, and it's going to be talked about, and it's always going to be, you know, asked to me about. So there's, you know, there's no ill feeling for me at all. It's just that, you know, I'm very proud to be, you know, knowing to myself that I have done it and I can do it again. If I can do it twice, then I can do it again as well.
Whose idea was it to get the 303 embossed on your Ford Mustang license plate?
It was, I don't remember clearly, but I think it was my idea only, because I wanted it. It's something that, you know, it just strikes your mind and you just want to do it, and at that moment you do it, and then, you know, there's no going back, and I wouldn't want to go back and change things that I've done at all. I have no regrets at all, and you know, I don't see anything wrong in doing what I did. And
absolutely,
it's obviously things that you cherish, and I'm really happy about it.
Absolutely. And the one incident that I also remember, just after the 303 you scored, I think you were in Kerala at your hometown to attend one of these temple festivals, when six people actually drowned in a boat accident, and you just at that time the report said that you were just lucky to escape by a cat's whisker and all that. Did that incident kind of make you revisit the way you just approach life, approach things in general?
It was before, actually. It was before my test debut and
right.
Everything.
So correct.
I was given a second chance at life, and you know, really sad moment that, because we lost. There were two people lost their lives, and you know, one of them were related to me, and really a sad moment for the family and everything. So, but yes, it did give me a sense of, you know, looking at life at different angles, and to know that how fortunate we are to have the things that we have, and to be given the life that we have been given. Not many people can be. You know, given this kind of life, and really made me look at myself and what I have very differently, and very grateful to everything that I have.
Does that thought kind of help you when you're probably, you know, ruining the fact that you were dropped from the India side, you know, three test matches after you scored your 300? Does that kind of help you reconcile with these setbacks in your career?
Yeah, see, there are only certain things that are in your control, and selection is not in your control. It's just, you know, the way it is. You just need to do, whenever you get the opportunity, you just need to make sure the bat does the talking, and nothing else is in your control. So I don't, you know, think about it too much at all. And everyone goes through these stages, and there's so many people who have come back through these stages stronger than ever, and just biding my time and waiting for the opportunity.
I'm sure it's going to come knocking on your door sooner than later. Another critical aspect in your development has been your IPL stints, right? I mean, right from Royal Challengers to Rajasthan Royals to Delhi Daredevils. Of course, in the last two franchises that I mentioned, you had Rahul Dravid's mentorship as well. And now, of course, with Kings 11 Punjab. So across this whole journey of, IPL franchises, what's the biggest learning been for you at different phases of IPL?
I think, every team that I've been to has posed a different challenge and posed a lot of challenging situations to me. And I think I've given my best in all the situations that I've been faced with, and I think I've done really well in all situations, except for when I played for RCB. I think I got two opportunities and I didn't do too well, and then didn't get any more opportunities, and then the next opportunity came and I was Rajasthan Royals, and that time I was really determined to not let go of that again, and what I didn't want what happened with RCB to happen again with RR. So I was really determined, and by then, I had also played a couple of years of first class cricket, and that actually really helped me to understand my game better. Every team that I've been to, every season has been a different challenge and faced with different situations, and I've batted everywhere in the batting order, from opening to number 3 to number 4 to number 5 to number 6, yeah. And I've batted number 7 also at certain situations. So it's always been a different challenge and things to learn, different experiences every year. So I'm very grateful to the opportunities that I've had, and I'm really proud of the things that I've done in the IPL, and I'm looking forward to doing more of it and contributing to winning more games for the team, and hopefully winning an IPL title soon.
Absolutely. There is one particular drill of yours that I very vividly remember while at Delhi Daredevils. You got Rahul Dravid to, just roll the ball slowly, and then you just put your whole body weight through the ball, trying to pack a punch while you were hitting your shots. Are there other quirky drills that you kind of rely on to, stay ahead of the game?
Not really. I think all batsmen have things that they go to. When they're doing well, they want to keep repeating the things that they have been doing each game. So it was just something that, I was doing well at that moment, and I wanted to keep doing the same things over and over again so that, I got into the same zone, same mindset. So it was things like that, you just find things that happen when you do well, and then you want to keep that with you, and you want to keep repeating that over and over again so that it becomes a habit. And that drill was just one of those instances where, I wanted to repeat what was working for me and what was, helping me get into that zone.
Right. Kings 11 Punjab, for all the right reasons, has also been called Kings 11 Karnataka, given the sheer number of Karnataka players in the side. And now you've got Anil Kumble as well, right at the top. Have you had a chance to strike up a conversation with him, right before the lockdown happened? I mean, when the auction, the squads were all finalized.
Yeah, I think as soon as he was announced as the coach, I think he made it a point to speak to every player. So he did speak to me, and he did speak to me about how things are going with me, and what he expected of me to be working on, and what he thought that my role might be in Kings 11 from moving forward and all that. So it was nice to catch up with him after some time, and he's someone that you can go up to and speak to any time of the day, and give a call to him any time of the day. So really happy to have him in Kings 11 as well.
Is he as strict as he sounds, as his baritone sounds like?
Not really. I think he's a very chill person. He does ask for a lot of focus, and he asks for a lot of determination from his players, and a lot of play to the role kind of players. So he does ask a lot, but he's not very like how he's portrayed to be, and he's very chill. He talks to you normally. He talks to you. He's very. You can walk up to him anytime and speak to him about anything. And he's, very. He's got a good sense of humor, and you know, he's a very nice person to be around with, and I think we're very glad that we have him in Kings 11 this year, and hopefully we can do well for the team and for ourselves.
One of your closest friends is now the captain of Kings 11 Punjab, but also, I mean, just the kind of to understand the kind of bond that you share. Even at the time when you were out of the national side and he was again establishing himself, and when again he got out of the test side as well, what have your conversations been like? Is he the kind of guy who just call you up to check on you every once in a while and, you know, just give you that little bit of a lift? And do you do that as well? How does that work?
Not really. I think we meet so often that we live in a city where, you know, you can catch up any time of the day, and we don't live too far away, so
okay.
It's not like we need to call or speak, and because we see each other so much so many times in a week itself, so we speak just face to face, and in the stadium we keep bumping into each other in the stadium during practice and all that, and gym sessions and everything. So, you know, there's no need for us. I think
it's good to be left alone sometimes.
So deep that also it's like we known each other for so long that even if we don't speak for a long time, you know, there's no disconnect between you.
Correct.
If you know what I mean. So
absolutely.
So, so, you know, there's never been an instance where one of us have picked up the call and called each other or anything like that, because you know, we just speak to each other normally face to face when we see.
Right. Karun has also had a lot of changes on the personal front as well. You got married recently, and there is this new adorable member of the family, Theodore, who's also come into your lives. So how's that side of your life treating you? How has that, you know, centered you as a person?
Marriage has been good. It's something new, something that, you know, I'm getting used to, if you can say. And also having a new member, and I've never been, I've never grown up with pets or anything. So to have a pet at home is something new for me. So I'm gradually getting into it, gradually getting to do it, getting to know what to do and when to do it. And, you know, it's when you're not born around it, or when you're not growing up around it, you kind of stay away more than you stay with it. So I think this last month or so has been different, and I've kind of learned to do things and learned to get closer as well.
I've been told that you're someone who's very big on your music. You really enjoy your collection of music. Is that a certain, do you have certain soundtracks that you keep going back to before a big game or a big innings?
Honestly, in the last couple of years, I've kind of lost touch with the music. Before that, I used to actually, you know, go behind what was playing and go search for music and, you know, make sure that I have it on my playlist. But yes, I've tried to get back most of those playlists and those songs back into my playlist now. And yes, I used to listen to a particular song or particular playlist before a match. So I think every cricketer listens to a particular playlist.
Could you name the songs?
Not really. Like I said, I've not been in touch very in the last few years, and but yes, right. I have managed to, you know, put up a playlist and keep listening to it.
Karunakku Malayala cinema le interest undo?
Malayala cinema le kudal interest illa, but in the last 1 month I have watched a lot of Malayalam movies. Not lots, at least a couple of Malayalam movies.
Which are the ones that you liked? I'm assuming that you watched movies like Driving License, Ayyappanum Koshiyum.
No, those are the new ones. I watched the older ones. I watched Anglo Days and a couple of them other. I don't remember the names, but I watched the older ones. I'm planning on watching the ones that you told me of just now. I have it on my watch list, but it's just, you know.
There's a huge watch list of Malayalam cinema. Of course, in the last 4-5 years, they've come up with some amazing movies. Do you have a favorite actor that you really enjoyed watching as a boy? And do you still have favorite heroes?
Growing up, I liked Mohanlal and Dilip.
So
right now, I don't have any favorite heroes as such. It's just that, like I said, I haven't watched many Malayalam movies in the recent past. Now, when I've got the time, I've actually gone back and, you know, on Amazon Prime or on the different platforms that you get to watch, I've actually gone back and watched it. So, looking forward to watch more Malu movies in the future.
Absolutely. And just a little while ago, Yuzvendra Chahal popped up and he just called you Pokemon Kulla Paji. What does that mean? What's the inside track?
I think there was a stage where, you know, this game called Pokemon had come out, and everyone used to take their phones out and, you know, go and search or whatever. So I think that's why he refers to me, because I used to play that game with him,
right.
Walk around with him. So, but Kulla, I have had this name Kulla from the time I started playing cricket, because I was
the height.
Yeah, because the height. But so that name has just stuck with me.
Smriti Sinha has an interesting question. If a biopic was to be made on you, which actor would you like to play your role?
Biopic actor, probably Saif Ali Khan.
Interesting choice. Are you big on Hindi cinema as well, watching a lot of Hindi films?
Yeah, like I said, I don't watch too many movies. Yes, now I've got the time to watch, and I've been watching a lot of, not really movies, TV shows and stuff like that. And so I'm actually a lot into Netflix and Amazon Prime,
right.
And Hotstar. So so now that I've got a few names on hand of the movies, I'm really, you know, looking forward to watching.
Remind me to send you a huge list of Malayalam cinema over the last 20 years, I think, that you should probably be watching.
And is asking for a bit much, I think.
Right, I'm sure there is a generation gap over there. What's that one good habit that you've picked up during these 4-5 weeks of lockdown? Even that could be a tiny accomplishment that you're really proud of.
Good habit. I think I have picked up to learn and how to wash dishes, probably. That's something that I learned in wash dishes. So many household things to do I've learned, and also I've also learned how to cook a few things now. So those are the things that I'm trying to do in these days, and really enjoying doing them and learning something new and trying to be a better person as well.
Right, and how do you stay in touch with your cricket? Are you the kind of guy who goes back to your old videos, keeps watching them over and over again?
Not really, not during these times at least, because, you know, it's already probably close to 6 weeks that, you know, I've touched the bat, 6 or 7 weeks,
right.
And at first it was quite enjoyable, the break, but now it's getting to a point where, you know, your hands are itching to get onto the ground and practice and, you know, play some games, and so now it's coming to that stage. So, but we still have to respect the situation that we are under. We have to respect what's going on, and what's more important right now is to, you know, make sure that everyone's safe and make sure that, you know, you follow everything that's been asked of you. So right now we have to just hold our temptations with us and go by doing things that you have to do to keep yourself safe and keep yourself at home.
Yeah, last couple of questions before we just let you go. You're this huge Manchester United fan, of course. What's the kind of inspiration you derive from non-cricket sports persons, and who are those sports persons that have inspired you, I mean, outside of cricket?
Yes, like you said, I am a Manchester United fan, huge Manchester United fan. The non-cricket sports person that inspires me a lot is Cristiano Ronaldo.
Okay.
You know, I've followed him since, you know, he joined Manchester United, and it's astonishing to see how someone can grow from
being just a normal player to being the best in the world. So,
right.
And the work that he has put in, and you know, the hard work that he has put in to, you know, get to where he has, and the determination and the focus that he has, that, you know, if you need to be the best in the world, you need to have something different in you, a different mentality, and it's, you know, something that, you know, really inspires me every day.
Do you see parallels of Ronaldo in any of the Indian cricketers that you've been privileged to play alongside?
Obviously, there's Virat Kohli, who, you know, who makes you feel that, you know, you want to be following what he's doing, and he does so many things right, and he's also the best in the world. So if he's become the best in the world, that means he's done most things right, and you know, he's just a wonderful player, and you know, he's such an inspiration for cricketing cricketers and all youngsters, and to see what he's been able to do in the last 10 years, it's something astonishing, and you know, something that everyone wants to follow and get inspired by. And same with me, you know, been lucky enough to be part of the same dressing room as him, and watch him very closely as well.
Lastly, I mean, it's a competitive scenario, at least as far as the India middle order is concerned, and you are a proven performer, all right, but for you to just, you know, break your way back into the side, but given the competition, and I'm sure you're going to be talking about your own processes and what you need to do, but realistically, given how difficult it is, what do you think you probably need to do? I mean, aside from all the big runs that you keep scoring, what do you think can actually give you an edge as far as making a comeback is concerned?
I think first and foremost, you need to be consistent in first class cricket and all the opportunities that you get in the India A level, to, you know, to actually have a chance to make a comeback. And also,
right,
you need to perform in every game that you get, be it Ranji Trophy, be it the India A games, or and even the IPL is a great platform to, you know, show that you're batting well. And for me, there's nothing much to prove that I can play at the highest level, because I've been there and I've done that, and I've done really, been able to score a big 100.
Yes.
You know, people have seen I can handle the situations well. So it's just about me being in the right frame of mind, and you know, being consistent in first class cricket and all the opportunities that I get, and I don't see it's, you know, something that, you know, really inspires me every day.
Do you see parallels of Ronaldo in any of the Indian cricketers that you've been privileged to play alongside?
Obviously, there's Virat Kohli, who, you know, who makes you feel that, you know, you want to be following what he's doing, and he does so many things right, and he's also the best in the world. So if he's become the best in the world, that means he's done most things right, and you know, he's just a wonderful player, and you know, he's such an inspiration for cricketing cricketers and all youngsters, and to see what he's been able to do in the last 10 years, it's something astonishing, and you know, something that everyone wants to follow and get inspired by. And same with me, you know, been lucky enough to be part of the same dressing room as him, and watch him very closely as well.
Lastly, I mean, it's a competitive scenario, at least as far as the India middle order is concerned, and you are a proven performer, all right, but for you to just, you know, break your way back into the side, but given the competition, and I'm sure you're going to be talking about your own processes and what you need to do, but realistically, given how difficult it is, what do you think you probably need to do? I mean, aside from all the big runs that you keep scoring, what do you think can actually give you an edge as far as making a comeback is concerned?
I think first and foremost, you need to be consistent in first class cricket and all the opportunities that you get in the A level, to, you know, to actually have a chance to make a comeback. And also,
right,
you need to perform in every game that you get, be it Ranji Trophy, be it the India A games, or and even the IPL is a great platform to, you know, show that you're batting well. And for me, there's nothing much to prove that I can play at the highest level, because I've been there and I've done that, and I've done really been able to score a big 100.
Yes.
You know, people have seen I can handle the situations well. So it's just about me being in the right frame of mind, and you know, being consistent in first class cricket and all the opportunities that I get, and I don't see any other difficulties to anything else to. And then, like I said, selection is not in your control. It's only certain things that you can do. And like I said before, the bat should do the talking. And if that does the talking for me, I think I wouldn't be faced with too many challenges after that. It's just about me going out there and expressing myself. And I'm really confident of, you know, once I get that opportunity again, I'm confident that I can, you know, cement my place this time. And go one better and do things that I've done before.
Since as a parting comment, since as a lot of your fans have been requesting a few words for you to say in Malayalam as well as Kannada, could you just try and string together a sentence for your fans where you can club both the languages together?
I can try.
Please.
To club both the languages together is really tough. You have no idea how tough that is, because
try Madi Guru.
I've been faced with so many interviews where, you know, I've done Malu interviews on one side and the next interview I have is a Kannada interview, and jumbled up in between. So to mix the both is little difficult, but I can try. Ellarkum bhayangara nanni and follow cheyunu ningalu, and Kannada, what to say? Kannada
Tumba thanks
ellargo Bangalore alli ellaru ella follow martta idara guidelines tumba strict agide illi. So now sakkadag martta idi Bangalore, even Kerala illu nallaite nadakunnundu ella cases thaya povunnundu. So hange martta iri Bangalore alli ellaru jothege banni jothege idanna muksana maneli irana stay home and stay safe, and you know, hopefully we can come together and come out stronger from this challenging situation that we are under.
Kolla valare nannayittu unde agana comment. Thumba thanks for all the time that you have given us, Karun. May we always see that broad beaming smile on your face all the time, and I hope that once this lockdown's over, once cricket resumes,